Good morning, friends. Welcome to Civispedia. Let us see the current affairs for 7th of July 2018. In our editorial discussion, we'll be seeing something about gambling in sports and the recommendation of Law Commission of India with respect to gambling in sports. We will be also seeing something about India's foreign policy and how India's foreign policy is moving. And in our focus prelim topics, we'll be seeing about National Commission for Safai Karamcharis. We'll be also seeing about WIPO, that is World Intellectual Property Organization, Khan Prahari and CEM SMS, and also about TAD abort test. So friends, let us go for today's topics. The gambling in sports. So the Law Commission of India has recently recommended that the gambling in sports could be legalized. So the we know that gambling and betting has been throughout a long tradition in India, especially we could start from Mahabharata. We could see that the Dharm Yudh of Mahabharata was the sole cause due to the gambling which was happening in India, which was happening during the ancient time between the Pandavas and Kauravas. So the gambling per se, it is impossible to totally eliminate from the face of India's sports because it is a part of India's culture and India's tradition. Hence, the Law Commission has said that instead of trying to totally eliminating, we could regulate it in a better manner so that it will be able to, it will lead to greater availability of resources, tax revenues to people and tax revenue to the government, which will be useful in public welfare measures. So the Supreme Court has asked the commission in 2016 to look into legalizing betting in cricket. In this case, the Law Commission of India has come up with a report, and it has reported to the government that since it is impossible to stop illegal gambling. So this is important, friends. It says that it is impossible to stop illegal gambling in India. The only viable option left is to regulate gambling in sports. Instead of stopping illegal gambling, which thrives in underground, which thrives in casinos, etc., it is better to regulate gambling in sports. And it will also strike at underground's control over illegal and unregulated gambling, which will lead to coming out of this gambling to a formal area, formal space. And the European nations have also legalized land-based and online casinos. The Law Commission has recommended cashless gambling in sports as a means to increase revenue and deal a blow to unlawful gambling. And the revenue could be taxed under the Income Tax Act and the GST Act, and revenue generated could be used for public welfare measure. So the major point or the major objective or the major pro, what is seen in the argument to legalize gambling is that, one, gambling cannot be eliminated. So instead of trying to push it more underground, it is rather better to regulate it, to take it over, to have government control over gambling. Second one is that gambling, by taxing revenues on gambling, it will be leading to public welfare measures. Third, it will deal a blow to underground activities. And fourth is that it will reduce money laundering. And fifth is that already many nations, Western nations, have legalized tax, have legalized casinos, and legalized gambling in both online as well as land-based. So India could follow this particular model. So FDA and FI, foreign exchange management laws and policies to be amended to encourage investment to create tourism and employment. So gambling, it is again done even in horse races across India. So it is not entirely a new phenomenon in India. It is already being prevalent in various activities in India. It is just that government can regulate it through various means. And it is a normal phenomenon between friends, colleagues, etc., whereby a bet is placed over a desired outcome and the person whose prediction wins also wins the bet. Also, Narada Smriti describes gambling as a lawful amusement when carried out in public gaming houses. The Narada Smriti and Kautilya also advocated gambling should exist under the control of states. So this is certain points which says for the gambling in India. Now, against a country as poor as India should not legalize gambling. So this is very important because India has a huge poverty. So if we start, already we saw the cons of lottery system in India. Poor people, they went, whatever they earned a day, maybe a 50 rupees, maybe 60 rupees, all they did means they went to buy lottery to see that whether they are getting a good fortune or not. This was leading to acute poverty in India, where only certain vested interests or the people who are running these lottery companies, they were earning a lot rather than poor who are not earning any little amount. Hence, If we, so hence lottery was banned in many states. So if you bring against such gambling, it will lead to poor going and trying their own fortune like in lottery, and this will lead to increasing in poverty in India, and it will affect the poor and make them even poorer than the rich. It will serve only the Western interest. Gambling will lead to other social evils such as alcoholism, drug abuse, sex trade, etc. And already lottery was banned by many states since poor people spend their money on their fortunes. So these are points which are said against gambling. Also, there is a strong voice against the land-based casinos in Goa. Gambling comes under the state subject in the 7th schedule. So it is totally the prerogative of the state government to allow or to disallow gambling in that particular state. And lesson learned from Mahabharata and the teachings of Gandhi are not to be forgotten. We know that gambling lead to a greater war between two power, Gauravas and Pandavas. Hence, Gandhiji was also strict opponent to such gambling, betting, etc. So when we learn lessons from our great leaders, we have to keep in mind that this will lead to only negative results rather than positive results. So the Law Commission also said that there will be certain restrictions which could be placed on gambling. First one is said that gamblers has to be linked with Aadhaar and PAN card, and entire transaction has to be made in cashless manner. So by making the entire transaction cashless manner and by linking to Aadhaar card and PAN card, it will lead to a greater revenue generation. It will make the entire process comes out of underground. It will make entire process legal in nature. Second is classification of gambling into proper gambling and small gambling. Proper gambling will be for rich and small gambling will be for low income groups, and also cap on the number of gambling transactions for each individual. This cap will be on weekly basis or monthly or quarterly or early. So we make place a cap on how many per person, how many times he can go to gambling houses or he can go to public casinos to gamble. By this way, we could regulate gambling, and also regulations to protect vulnerable groups from exploitation. So these are such restrictions which have been set by Law Commission of India to restrict gamble. So the way forward, the final call is with the parliament and state legislatures in this regard to legalize betting or gambling, either partially or wholly. Also, match fixing and sports fraud should be made as a criminal offense with maximum punishment. Since in India, gambling and they are not legal, and it's match fixing and sports fraud, they are also not punished. So when we have to make match fixing and sports fraud also a criminal offense. The next is India's foreign policy. So the government's vision of turning, we will be seeing how India's foreign policy is moving around. The government's vision of turning India into a leading power that is a net provider of security and prosperity in the South Asian region is not understated. So the first point says that we may see the first few points of pros of Indian foreign policy, or where Indian foreign policy is meeting such success. First is India's putting forward itself as a net provider of security and prosperity in the South Asian region. Second one is that it is conducting bilateral and multilateral naval exercises. An example is Malabar exercise, international fleet review, etc. So by conducting these exercises, India is proving itself as a net provider of security in the South Asian region. Also by signing various agreements such as trade and investment agreements such as RCEP, etc., India is also enabling prosperity in this region. So again, high level visits by Prime Minister to 55 nations has put much global focus on India. Cultural diplomacy, engaging with Indian diaspora. In the past few years, the engagement with Indian diaspora has been increasing a lot, and this is leading to greater soft power. So engagement with Indian diaspora, adding force multiplier to our soft power, tapping transnational Hindu and Buddhist linkages, has refined India's image as a repository of ancient wisdom. Again, commercial diplomacy, soft laws from Japan for high-speed rail development, higher FDI inflows and ease of doing business are also improving India's stature at a global level. Also, India's improving relationship with the US, Japan and Israel, as well as challenging the US might. Also, fighting against terrorism through surgical strikes, humanitarian rescue mission, and offering glimpses of national resurgence. All these points are said as positives of India's foreign policy. So, though we have certain positives, we also have certain challenges. The challenges include Russia's close coordination with China. Russia has been a traditional ally of India. But recent times, what is happening is that Russia is closely coordinating with China, and it is also signing different pacts between Pakistan as well as China. And also, we see recently a military exercise happened between Russia and Pakistan, which was called as Druzba 2017. This point states that Russia is moving away from India, whereas it is moving towards India's force in the region, or India's rivals in the region, that is Pakistan and China. India's neighbor Nepal, Maldives and Sri Lanka are also exploiting the China card. We could see recently whereby China, Sri Lanka has given the Hambantota port to China. Nepal's Prime Minister has visited China and he has spoken about a 2+1 dialogue. About Maldives. Maldives, it has recently said that it will not extend visa, and it has also sent back the Dornier aircraft or the helicopters which we gifted to Maldives. So these points, we see that these our neighboring nations, they are playing the China card with respect to India. Also, India's efforts to NSG membership, CCIT, facility in Seychelles, and UNSC reforms have been stymied. Also, there is a growing China's influence in the South Asian region. This could be seen through string of pearls theory. And also Belt and Road Initiative. Losing relevance of non-alignment movement when the Prime Minister had skipped the 2016 mid and postponement of 2+2 dialogue and Iran sanction issues. So while we have various success with respect to our foreign policies, we also have various challenges with respect to our foreign policies. So these are the focus areas where India must focus itself so that it can overcome these challenges. So the way forward is improving India's relationship with neighborhood and our traditional ally, that is Russia. Taking a more nuanced position with China over the Belt and Road Initiative, as well as improving our oil and energy security, as well as trade wars, which is recently happening between US and other nations, we should have a more better approach with respect to trade wars. So the next topic is National Commission for Safai Karmacharis. So the National Commission for Safai Karmacharis was constituted on 12th August 1994 as a statutory body by an act of the parliament, which is National Commission for Safai Karmacharis Act, for a period of 3 years. So this is important. Though the particular body was constituted in the year 1994 itself, it was said to function for only 3 years. Rather, it was given extension up to 2004, after which it ceased to exist as a statutory body. With current situation, the NCSK is a non-statutory body of the Ministry of Social Justice and Empowerment, and whose tenure is extended from time to time through a government resolutions. So we could say that NCSK is a non-statutory and executive body. So the working of the commission: the chairperson and the members of the commission undertake extensive touring of the country to study the socio-economic and living conditions of Safai Karmacharis and their dependents. So they take tours to study of how the Safai Karmacharis are functioning, what are the different ideas of Safai Karmacharis. During their visits, the member of the commission interact with Safai Karmacharis, both individually as well as through the representative associations. The grievances of Safai Karmacharis are then taken up by the commission with the concerned local and civil police authorities. The commission also receives complaints petitions from Safai Karmacharis, and the commission calls for factual reports in connection with these complaints. Based on the information received through print or electronic media, the commission also has the power to take suo motu cognizance. So in this case, if there is no complaint is being received, but there is a particular news report, for example, we could see that the Bellandur Lake issue, it was widely reported in the newspapers, and hence National Green Tribunal, it suo motu took the cognizance of this particular environmental issue, and it issued notices to the government of Karnataka. With the same concept, even the National Commission for Safai Karmacharis, it could take suo motu cognizance of various problems if it appears on print and electronic media, and it tries to resolve them by playing a proactive role. Again, whenever a matter is being investigated or inquired or into, or progress of any scheme has to be evaluated, the commission holds sittings, as many as possible, to look into these particular problems or to investigate in particular issues. Also, based on the findings, the commission gives its recommendations for rehabilitation and liberation of Safai Karmacharis from the scourge of manual scavenging to the Ministry of Social Justice and Empowerment through annual reports. So this is another important function. The important point is that the Safai Karamcharis, the commission, it has only recommendatory powers. So these powers, these recommendations are not binding. Since these recommendations are not binding, though many recommendations are being given to NCSK, to the Ministry of Social Justice and Empowerment, still these recommendations may be accepted, may not be accepted, etc. The important function is that to look into these complaints and to provide reports to the central government, that is to the Ministry of Social Justice and Empowerment. The fourth topic is WIPO, that is World Intellectual Property Organization. It was recently in news because the cabinet agreed to accede to the WIPO copyright treaty and WIPO performance and phonograms treaty that extends the coverage of copyrights to the internet. So this is important because in internet there is huge copyright violation that is happening, and by acceding this to these treaties, India now recognizes the copyrights issue with respect to internet. This will help creative right holders to enjoy rights for their work over the internet globally. The World Intellectual Property Organization is one of the 15 specialized agencies of the United Nations. WIPO was created in 1967 to encourage creative activity to promote the protection of intellectual property throughout the world. WIPO currently has 191 member states, administers 26 international treaties, and its headquarters is Geneva, Switzerland. So something important which you should know, friends, is first one is that it is a part of 15 specialized agencies of the UN. So please read about what these 15 specialized agencies. What are these 15 specialized agencies and what are the functions of these 15 specialized agencies? The second one is that the headquarters of WIPO is in Geneva, Switzerland. So whenever you read about any particular international organization or international body, it is important that you know where the headquarters of that particular organization is located. The fifth one is coal mine surveillance and management system. The basic objective of this CMSMS is reporting, monitoring, and taking suitable action on unauthorized coal mining activities. So it is a web-based GIS application through which location of sites for unauthorized mining can be detected and action could be taken with respect to unauthorized coal mining that is happening in India. Next one is Kran Prahari. This is an app which was developed recently, and the objective of the app is a tool for reporting any activity. If as citizens, if we see if there is certain illegal coal mining that is happening, then we could use this app to report such illegal mining to the government. So it's a tool for reporting any activity taking place related to illegal coal mining, like rat hole mining, pilferage, etc. One can upload geotagged photograph of the incident along with textual information directly to the system, and by this way a transparent system can be created, and the government could take action with respect to illegal mining of coal. The next is ISRO's Human Spaceflight Program. The Indian Human Spaceflight Program is a proposal by the ISRO to develop and launch the ISRO orbital vehicle, which should carry a two-member crew to the low Earth orbit. So this is an objective of Indian Human Spaceflight Program. It is to develop and launch a ISRO orbital vehicle and to carry two-member to the low Earth orbit. And the program envisages the development of a fully autonomous orbital vehicle while carrying two crew members to about 300 km low Earth orbit and their safe return. The spaceship would be launched by the GSLV Mark III launcher. Pre-project activities have been initiated to study and develop critical technologies. CAR, that is Crew Module Atmosphere Re-entry Experiment, was carried out in 2015, while pad abort tests were carried out recently. So friends, a small homework is that please read up with this GSLV. Also, please do a comparative analysis between PSLV and GSLV. What is PSLV and GSLV? Also, please read about low Earth orbit, medium Earth orbit, geostationary orbit, geosynchronous orbit, geostationary transfer orbit. These are various orbits which respect to space science in India. Please read about various launches, various orbits. Also, please read about various satellites. That is, India majorly have two satellite types. That is, INSAT series, INSAT GSAT series. Then next one is IRS, that is remote sensing satellite. So this is a communication satellite, while IRS is a remote sensing satellite. So please read about these points. Also, please know about CAR, that is Crew Module Atmosphere Reentry Experiment, as well as pad abort test. What is the importance of these two tests? Thank you, friends. If you have any doubt, please post it on the comment section.